Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in 2017. Can I ask everyone to switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode, please, so that they do not affect the committee's work this morning? Item one, our first item today is to decide whether to take item three in private. Do members agree?
Yes.
Thank you. Item two, we will now take oral evidence on the Joint Accounts Commission and Auditor General report entitled Maintaining Scotland's Roads, a follow-up report. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting Liz Ditchburn, Director General Economy of the Scottish Government, Roy Brannan, Chief Executive, Hugh Gillies, Director of Trunk Roads and Bus Operations, and Donald Morrison, Head of Asset Management and Procurement, all of Transport Scotland. Unfortunately, Colin Mayer was not able to make the meeting this morning due to transport complications that were not of his making. We highlight in advance of today's meeting five areas arising from the audit that we would like to discuss in more detail. I invite Liz Ditchburn to make an opening statement before I open up to questions from members.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to give evidence. My remarks focus on the trunk roads network for which Scottish Government through Transport Scotland is directly responsible. Our trunk road network is used daily for hundreds of thousands of journeys and is vital to our economic prosperity. It represents only 6% of the road network, but carries over 35% of all traffic and over 60% of HGV traffic. It has a gross asset value of £20.8 billion. And if something goes wrong with this network, it can impact on large numbers of people very quickly, as indeed we've seen this morning, and have serious economic consequences. The Audit Scotland report highlights the importance of decision makers being able to make informed choices about the balance of investment in new infrastructure and in the existing network, and it highlights the importance of managing our maintenance activity effectively to get value for the public purse. I believe that the successive audit reports, of which this is part of a series, help show how Transport Scotland has developed a mature asset management approach embodied in the Road Asset Management Plan and a strong model of oversight of the asset, including through the Independent Performance Audit Group. Transport Scotland has developed long-term financial models that allow us to understand both the budget required to achieve various condition targets and the impact of different levels of investment on condition. Since the committee took evidence from Audit Scotland, the latest annual report of the Performance Audit Group has been published with the 2015-16 data on performance of the operating companies, and I think you have access to that. The last few years have seen a really clear strategy of significant investment in our transport infrastructure to create a platform for economic growth and as an economic stimulus in its own right. Alongside these major projects, Transport Scotland have rigorously managed our available maintenance spend to get the most from it through effective procurement, performance management and targeting. But when decision makers come to look at the next phase of our transport infrastructure strategy, Transport Scotland have the data and analysis to model and assess different options and to inform what may well be, in a constrained financial setting, difficult choices. In the short term, information about the maintenance needs of the network resulted in an additional £50 million for trunk road maintenance in 2016-17 as part of the £100 million capital package announced in September. The draft budget for 17-18, which of course is going through parliamentary process, proposes an increase from the £305 million spent in total this year on management, maintenance and operation of the trunk road network to a proposed £368 million. Although not within the scope of the original Audit Scotland report, the committee has been very interested and keen to understand, I know, more about the response to the allegations made against Bear, one of our operating companies. We take allegations of this nature extremely seriously and commissioned a full investigation and have acted on its findings. In assessing future risk, I draw assurance from Audit Scotland's view that the Performance Audit Group provides the basis of a robust system of internal control over the operating companies and that Transport Scotland acted appropriately when it received the allegations. If the committee would find it helpful, we can give much more detail about the further work done by Bear and by Transport Scotland as a result of this case. Also very happy to talk to all the questions that you've raised. And indeed, I'm very confident that my colleagues between them represent many years of expertise and experience in this area. And I'm sure that you know, I'm looking forward to a really good evidence session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'd like to ask Colin Beattie to open up questioning.
Thank you, Convener.
I think the thing that strikes me looking at this is, in some ways, the complexity of the landscape that we see in front of us. There's 33 roads authorities, so I understand from the submission by Roads Collaboration Programme. And it's pretty calm, Mayor's not here, but perhaps I can ask you some questions on this. We've got 33 roads authorities. There's apparent complexity of political decision-making. Audit Scotland's report itself on paragraph 47 said that only a third of councils are presenting options to elected members on the road condition that can be expected from different levels of spending, which seems a pretty obvious option to go in front of members. How efficient are local councils? How efficient is the present system of delivering for a road system?
Maybe if I just start really briefly, but colleagues should talk to this in much more detail. I think the Audit Scotland report shows really clearly the kinds of elements that should be in place in terms of good asset management. So understanding the condition of the asset, understanding its value, being able to make informed decisions about costs and how expenditure should be used. And I think Audit Scotland recognises that Transport Scotland, with respect to the trunk roads, have been able to go a long way down that journey of having that really mature process. The report also says very clearly that councils are currently in a very different, very variable states of capability and distance down that journey. So I think the report shows clearly that there is variability, that the overall system is not working as anybody would want it to do in its totality, and there are some real important opportunities with the next generation of contracts that we will be coming to in due course, which create different options for different kinds of models. But let me ask Roy or Hugh to speak to that in more detail.
Yes, thank you. It's quite a difficult picture, and it's probably not one for us to answer and specifically around efficiency of the local authorities. But what I will do is go back a bit to 2011 when we set up the National Roads Maintenance Review, all 33 of us, and I chaired that review. The outcome of that was 30 options, option 30 being to look at collaboration and shared services. And it's suffice to say that I think Audit Scotland recognised that there's still a way to go yet until we truly get to a point where we've got true efficiencies coming through the makeup of how we undertake trunk road maintenance and local authority maintenance across the piece. There are some good examples of collaboration with our own trunk road contracts. I was with Argyll and Bute yesterday, and Argyll and Bute have a collaborative approach to trunk road maintenance on the Kennacraig to Campbelltown section, as do Transerve with Dumfries and Galloway. So there are pockets of good activity. The Ayrshires is another good example of that, but I think there's more to be done. And that's really the task of the Strategic Action Group, chaired by the Minister and Stephen Hagan, to try and determine exactly how we get that pace into collaboration going forward. So it might not answer your question directly around efficiencies, but I think everybody recognises there's more to be done.
I could add that it's true to say we obviously have 33 roads authorities in Scotland, and is that the best model to go forward? And as Roy has said, it's not for us to comment directly on local government and how they've gone about roads administration in recent times, given the fiscal challenge they've faced, as we have. But I think if you look at it another way, if you were to start with a blank bit of paper, would you come up with 33 roads authorities for Scotland? I think the answer would be no.
Do you believe there should be one national authority for all roads?
I don't think, well, that has been put out there as a thought piece, but I think in terms of what should be looked at is we need a mature reflection through the Strategic Action Group to look at potential models that could come forward. Now, that's obviously one model that could be looked at, but there are other models that have been looked at, for example, regional models. So I think there's a conversation needs to be had around models which are fit for purpose for varying parts of Scotland. It's not a one-size-fits-all, I think, would be one of the thoughts would have to be taken forward.
If I could just come in there, I think that's entirely right. It can't be a one-size-fits-all model. And a good example of that was in the discussion I had with Argyll and Bute yesterday, where they indicated that if we did end up in a situation where trunk road expertise, local authority expertise, professional expertise was taken out of Argyll and Bute in a situation where they've got an ageing population and they're trying to retain population in the area, that would be a difficult model for them. So I think it has to be recognised that there are different approaches required across the piece. And one of the things we've set up as part of the SAG, is a task force to look at how we can work closer together with our local authority colleagues through the further procurement of the fifth generation of our operating company contract. So that's one avenue, but there are other avenues that I'm sure Colin would have wished to explore today if he was here.
Liz Ditchburn mentioned about new contracts. New contracts are not going to solve the problems. They may hopefully improve a bit of efficiency and oversight and all the rest of it, but they're not going to resolve all these issues.
Well, I was referring to the same point that Roy was there, that at the point at which we move from one set of contracts to whatever follows it, you have an opportunity at that point to explore and put in place different models. So the 5G, the next generation of contracts would need to start in more or less what sort of timing?
It comes into being in 2020, but we start working on it now.
Yeah. So working back from that, there are opportunities now and over the course of this year to sit down with, in these collaborative forums that exist and that are working, to look at what would the best ways of structuring the whole system, and then what would the implications be for the kind of contracts that we would need to let. So it's there's an open window there to say, as you move from one, you know, from one generation of contract to another, you have the opportunity to rethink. And I think, you know, the sort of mature reflection that Hugh was talking about, to say, let's really look at what the options might be, and look at how they would fit within the context of different areas within Scotland and different challenges. But that's an option.
There's two things working in tandem here, and if Colin was here, he would explain a bit more about the road collaboration programme. And I think he's mentioned in his submission about the Governance First project, and that's the project that's looking at sharing on a regional basis across council boundaries and setting up governance arrangements to enable that to happen. And that's obviously something that's been taken forward by the board. And the other thing that's happening, of course, is preparation for the next round of trunk road contracts. But these two things can happen in tandem, because obviously with trunk road contracts coming to an end in 2020, we have to be in a position to ensure continuation of service. So that procurement journey has to start almost now. So in doing that, we're also exploring between Transport Scotland and local authorities through the Scots Network, the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation. We're exploring opportunities there would be to collaborate through the contract. But at the same time, the Governance First project is looking at regional arrangements. So these two things will continue in tandem. And obviously, in developing contracts, we can be flexible in terms of what the outcome of that is.
Reference has been made to shared services, but you know, frankly, this committee's looked at various organisations, local government and so on, and shared services have not been a huge success. Why will shared services work in the roads network if it's not working particularly well elsewhere?
I think, again, if Colin was here, and I think, you know, we obviously talk to our colleagues in the local authorities, and we do share, we have examples of Roy was referencing, we share services with Gowland Butte, we have also in the case of the Fries and Galloway, and we have pockets of it. But I think Colin would say, and I think I would reflect on the fact that shared services can work on occasions, if that, again, it's that horses for courses, but it's not going to be the panacea. We understand that. So it will work for some, in some instances, but not always the case.
And where it doesn't work, what do you do?
Well, that's the opportunity to reflect back. I mean, clearly, as I say, that if councils are having difficulties now in delivering the services for a variety of reasons, some of that's about fiscal, some of it's about professional persons available. There is an acknowledgement through the National Roads Review that we're heading towards a challenge in Scotland in just having enough transport and engineering professionals. So that, again, that's part of that mature reflection that we need to have about how do we map out the future of road administration in Scotland at a national, regional and local level.
There must be a timescale for coming to some sort of conclusion on that. I realise there's local government review in the background on this also, but in the shorter term perhaps, what sort of timescale are we looking at to try and achieve some sort of a consensus as to how we handle our road system?
Well, I think if I could come in on that one, I think we've probably got, I would say, a two-year window to look at the scope of shared services and where the Governance First project might go. That would take us towards the tail end of 2018. And at that point, if that hasn't developed sufficiently, at that point you're pressing the button on trunk road maintenance contracts. Obviously you have to go out to the market and run a procurement, and we would need a good 18 months to do that if we were to deliver new trunk road maintenance contracts in time to ensure continuation of service. So before we press the button, before Transport Scotland presses the button on the procurement process itself, we've probably got about 2 years to look at what opportunities there are for Transport Scotland and local authorities to collaborate through a 5G contract. But at the same time, the Governance First project's got an opportunity to take forward a remit to look at shared services on a regional basis. So over the next 2 years, that's the sort of critical period that we've got from an activity point of view.
There's an important milestone, which the Audit Scotland report refers to, which is the Strategic Action Group publishing an update on the recommendations and the work done to date before the end of December 2017. So I think that's a place where we'll want to, the Strategic Action Group will want to be very clear about what might those options look like and what progress is being made.
Can I just say, I mean, the Roads Collaboration Programme was launched in 2013. It doesn't sound as if a whole lot of progress has been made since then, or is that incorrect?
I think there has been some progress. Obviously, the Governance First project has been set up, and I think that's been successful in setting up, Colin would need to have confirmed it, but I'd be right in saying that all 32 local authorities are signed up to a regional group in some shape or form, so there's nobody excluded from this, and some have agreed shadow joint committees and the like. So I think there has been progress in setting up a governance arrangement where they maybe haven't got over the line is actually putting these things and getting it through chief executives. So that's kind of the next stage. So there's been progress there.
That's over. We're 2017 now. If it was set up in November 2013. They've just agreed to set up a process. I mean, that's not much progress for three years.
I would totally agree with that, and that's exactly what Audit Scotland are saying in the report, is that progress has been slow. So the challenge is obviously there for local authorities and Transport Scotland to pick up the pace on that.
And why has that progress been slow?
It's difficult to say. I mean, I think there seems to have been an inertia in getting it going. And getting people around the table to actually make progress. But I think at an officer level, they've been keen to make progress, and in putting together arrangements and looking at projects such as skills gaps and future resource pressures. There's a separate project running on that. So officers have been keen and making progress on that, but it's getting it going, getting approval at a higher level, I think, to push it along. I think that's probably been the
from
risk.
Chief executives.
Yeah. Well, that's my impression. As I say, it would really need Colin to speak to those matters, but I'm just sort of giving a kind of an outside view on that.
Yeah, I think if Colin was here, he'd probably, as an independent chair, if you like, of the Road Collaboration Board, he'd probably give you a more fuller response on what his views are in terms of the pace of change. It's not for the lack of effort from officers. I would say I think there's a great deal of understanding about the condition of the asset, the skills that are required to deal with it, but we are where we are in terms of that position on pace, and Audit Scotland have recognised that again. So if there's one thing that's come out of this, it'll be a new impetus again for the Strategic Action Group, for elected members to try and drive this on and come back by the end of this year with a firmer plan about how we move towards a different model. What I would say in our defence in Transport Scotland, the 4G contracts have a collaboration element built into the contract. We proactively ask our OCs to try and look for opportunities. So there is a mechanism in which we can try and force the pace, if you like, but we've set up the task force to try and to see whether we can actively get people involved in the development of the 5G contracts as we head towards 2020. But I think the correct structure's in place with the Strategic Action Group.
Thank you. Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Convener, and also to declare an interest as a serving councillor on Aberdeen City Council. The Audit Scotland report highlights that the condition of trunk roads has declined from 90% in acceptable condition in 2011-12 to 87% in 2014-15. Now, over that very same period, Transport Scotland's expenditure on the trunk road maintenance fell from 168 million in 2011-12 to 162 million in 2014-15. Therefore, it's a straightforward question to begin with. Would you agree that there is a direct correlation between road condition and the level of spend?
I think the honest answer is yes. I mean, that's we've recognised that there is depending on the level of investment that you put into your assets, that determines exactly what happens in terms of the asset condition. We've got a very good understanding now of our assets across the trunk road network, and Donald and the team do a huge amount of effort in trying to identify each part of the inventory. So we've got 87,000 gullies, 12,500 kilometres of lines. A huge amount of asset, and it's understanding that asset first and foremost, and then identifying the best time to intervene with the funds that are available. And I think that's the position we're in at the minute, is that we're continuing with the level of funding that we've got at the minute and maintaining a reasonable condition. So we're bubbling up over at the same sort of 84-86% over the last few years, slowing down the deterioration, but certainly no significant improvement.
Obviously, correct to say. I mean, the focus of our asset management plan is getting in our maintenance programmes is getting the best value out of the pounds that we are spending. And obviously, we'll talk about performance of operating companies and how that's is scrutinised, and the performance measures that are in there and the various things that they have to do to prove value for money for the maintenance programmes that they're putting forward. And that obviously influences, you know, getting the best value for the pound. But as Roy says, probably the biggest influencing factor on road condition is investment. It's probably no surprise.
Following on from that, the submission from, I know he's not here, but following on from the submission from the Roads Collaborative Programme to the committee, it states, and I'll quote from it, "In recognition of concerns over local road condition in England, the UK Government Chancellor has chosen to invest in the local roads network in England. A similar allocation to Scotland's roads would be timely." Now, the investment that's been referred to in that submission is £168 million pothole repair fund for 148 English local authorities, with the aim being to fill more than 3 million potholes. Now, in 2014, I actually wrote to John Swinney at the time, asking if the Scottish Government would even consider investigating the possibility of replicating a similar scheme. In August 2014, the response was no. Has the Scottish Government looked at exploring the potential for such a scheme? And do you think, looking at the response from Audit Scotland and about the deterioration, that now is the time we should look at whether or not this is something that could be applicable in Scotland?
Ask Roy to talk explicitly to what we have and haven't looked at different times. But I think it's really important to state the obvious, which is that these are the choices that governments have to make. And there are no easy choices. If the entire purpose of the government was to make sure that the road condition was absolutely in the best condition possible and we weren't trying to do anything else, then it would be straightforward. But I mean, as you know, we're always trying to balance different things. And I think, as I said at the beginning, there's been a very, very clear strategy here of a major investment in new infrastructure. And alongside that, a really smart use of the maintenance budget to get the absolute maximum out of that maintenance budget. And although, obviously, the overall level of investment is a major determinant of the condition of the roads, then you can use that money well or less well. So let's not forget that the how you use that money really, really matters as well in terms of what you get back from it. So I think what we've got is a pattern of, you know, a really major investment in new projects, and alongside that, a really an increasingly effective use of the maintenance budget. But obviously, there will come decisions into the future around at what point you need to flip that and change that, and at what point, you know, there are elements of critical parts of the network, critical parts of infrastructure that you absolutely need to move into a potentially quite significant asset renewal phase. So I think Roy might want to say a bit more about that sort of overall dynamic. And our roads and the nature of our roads might determine a different pattern than the expenditure that's happened in England. So I think, you know, the decisions that were right for England were taken by the UK government. You know, it doesn't mean to say that we should necessarily replicate that. We need to think about our asset, our network, what's right for Scotland and what the dynamic might be over a series of years. But Roy, would you like to say more?
Yeah, well, we haven't done any specific work on a particular fund for local authorities. I think the agreed position is that the block grant approach is given to local authorities, and it's up to them how they spend that. I think Liz is right in terms of our approach, and Mr. Neil will be aware of this, but the infrastructure investment plan, which set out a path of both targeting new capital investment in our trunk road network, as well as continuing to maintain, we're starting to see the tail end of that now. So we've got £2.6 billion worth of investment coming to fruition in the next year or so, which is equivalent to 126 kilometres of new carriageway. So that will improve the asset condition, undoubtedly, because we've got a section of the M8, M73, M74, which will come on stream, as well as the new M90 across the Queens Ferry crossing. So that will make a difference. So I think hand in hand, it's right to have a balance between new infrastructure and asset renewal sums of money. But it's, as Liz says, there will become a point in time when we need to adjust that ratio ever so slightly to ensure that our ageing asset is dealt with accordingly. And a good example of that is the condition of our motorways at the minute. We've had a 2% improvement on the last year, so we're in a decent place, but our motorways are quite ageing, so a lot of them were built in the early 60s and 70s. M90, M74, parts of the M74 and parts of the M8, and that will require investment in the short to medium term.
Issue coming back to that one. In the absence of a pothole fund, what the Scottish Government has chosen to do in the past, and I know it predates your 2014 request, they have made one-off ad hoc awards to a pothole fund in year. Probably all remember the severe winters of 2010 and 2011. In the spring of both those years, the Scottish Government gave ring-fence pothole money to local authorities and to Transport Scotland. I think it was £5 million the first year and £15 million the following year. So that these were fairly sizeable sums that were admittedly one-off, but they were specifically for potholes. And another example of that more recently was last winter after the flooding events. There was £5 million of emergency flooding money made available to reinstate infrastructure, and I think Aberdeenshire got quite a lot. They had one road in particular, it was the A93. There was a failure there with a road washed away in the flooding, so quite a bit of the money went into that. So there are the Scottish Government tends to deal with specific pressures as and when they come, with relation to potholes, rather than setting up intention to set up a pothole fund.
Well, thank you for your answers. I know there's also been mention of investment in new roads infrastructure. Recent transport surveys show that about 84% of Scots would prefer to see investment in the current roads infrastructure and believe there needs to be more investment in the existing roads network. Given that fund introduced by the UK government was in 2014 and now we're in 2017, has the government at all carried out any analysis in relation to the impact that fund has had in England? Because in relation to best practice, I expect my roads officers in Aberdeen to always be looking at what's happening in other authorities to learn, of new practices that we can introduce. Has Transport Scotland done the same in relation to this policy?
Not in relation to local authority roads, but we are taking a watching brief on the development in relation to the strategic network. So Highways Agency became Highways England in 2015 with a particular direction and fund to improve the condition of their network, 80% of their network by the end of the first reporting period, which is 2019-20, I think it is. So we're watching carefully how that model works, that investment. And I think the important point to get across here, and it's one that was made through the National Roads Maintenance Review, is certainty of budgets over a longer period of time will make that difference both to the supply chain and to the asset. And that's exactly what Highways England have been set up to do. So it's a GoCo arm's length company, but their direction is to improve the condition of the strategic network. And as I say, we're watching that quite closely to see if that's going to have a dramatic impact.
Can you carry out some analysis on the impact of the pothole repair fund in the UK?
That would be possible?
Yeah, I think we could do that through the UK Roads Board. Both Transport Scotland and Scots are represented on the UK Roads Board. That group involves representatives from English local authorities as well. So through that group, we could certainly do some. We could certainly get feedback, and we could write to you with that when we get it. I think one thing that the Audit Scotland report, I think it does note somewhere, it does obviously make comparisons in spend, and I think the current position that they identify for roads in England, for local roads in England, is that and trunk roads as well, is that condition is stable and has been for the last few years. That's the only thing that's mentioned in the Audit Scotland report on that.
It's probably no surprise, as an MSP, one of the concerns that you hear most regularly from constituents is round about the condition of roads, and that's not just residents but businesses as well, particularly in Aberdeen. If we continue to see road spend at its current level, or if we actually see it reduced, what's the consequences going to be for road maintenance going into the future?
Well, I think probably the main thing to say is, as we spoke about earlier, investment is pretty much directly related to road condition. So we would continue with our value management processes to identify the most important schemes to do. It might have an influence on our road condition indicator. So road condition may, what we're doing at the moment is arresting a decline. So it would be more difficult to do that if the investment wasn't there. But probably the most obvious impact would be that instead of doing planned major maintenance work, which can give you the long term, like restore the long term life of the asset, we'd be doing more in the way of short-term treatments. So we'd be doing a lot of patching and resurfacing type schemes, rather than where a road comes to the end of its life, you dig it out and you completely replace it, and that will restore its design life for 20 or maybe even up to 40 years if it's a long life pavement. But in the absence of that, we continue to keep our roads safe by doing shorter term treatments, and by in that way we can keep the customer service going, if you like.
Can I maybe add to that you mentioned business, that we place a great stock in making sure that we have good a relationship with business, and particularly I think we're talking about here about the freight side. So we have a very good relationship with the Freight Transport Association and the Road Haulage Association, and working with them in further efforts to protect our network and also the local road network is what we're introducing an initiative just being rolled out just now, and that is we're using new technology to monitor overweight vehicles which may be on our network. We know they're on our network. Generally speaking, roads and bridges in the United Kingdom and Scotland are built for a standard 44 ton vehicle. That's the design standard. But we know from research and from looking around the world that there's probably about 5% of the HGV fleet runs about 10% over its maximum allowable weight. Now that disproportionately eats into the life of an asset, be it the road itself or affects a structure, and that can't continue. And to be fair, the Road Haulage Association, the Freight Transport Association recognise that. So we're working with the Driver Standards Vehicle Agency, United Kingdom Organisation, Police Scotland, ourselves, the Traffic Commissioner, to come together as an alliance. Now, this is not to criminalise logistics companies. This is to drive good behaviours. Mm-hmm. And we'll be able to do that by having what we call way in motion as vehicles travel along the network, an automatic number plate recognition. And we'll have them. We're going to start with 5 locations in Scotland. I'm not going to divulge them in committee, you'll understand. But that will allow us to understand what is happening in terms of these overweight vehicles. And through these agencies, we'll be able to approach logistics companies and just let them know they're running about heavy and they might want to change their behaviours.
Okay, that's interesting. Hopefully they listen, unlike the driver who went over the fourth crossing recently. on a slightly different tact, it's obviously been mentioned whether having 32 different roads authorities is sometimes the most practical or best way of trying to ensure maintenance of the roads. My question would be, just from my own experience at a local level, a council level, having those decisions taken at the localest of levels sometimes can be the most effective, because they kind of understand the road network, understand the community. So is there not an argument that sometimes it's better having those decisions taken at the localest possible level?
I think there's probably a distinction there between, you're absolutely right, I think there is a need for that local accountability, governance and foresight in relation to a geographic area. But for the strategic trunk road network, it's slightly different. It's set up in the 1930s to connect every part of Scotland. It's the backbone of Scotland. It's the workhorse of moving goods and people about the country. It connects every ferry port or thereby. It's within 5 miles of all the major airports, connects all our cities. So it's fundamentally important. And what we've understood over the last few years is that Hugh and I have probably sat in the best part of 200 odd score calls, and this second item on the agenda is transport, and usually transport into trunk roads, and that's because of the level of importance of an incident affecting our trunk road and affecting the goods and movements of vehicles across the trunk road. And the Forth Road Bridge closure was a classic example of that. So I think there needs to be a slight distinction between the oversight and management of the strategic network and that of the distributing network that supports the strategic network.
I think you've just articulated the design criteria that this thinking around what a future model might be needs to do. So how do you maintain or even strengthen the local accountability and the subsidiarity of decision making, while at the same time recognising that you have an asset of national strategic importance that must be managed as a critical asset for the whole country? And I think that's how do you hold national level interests and local level interests, get the governance right for both of those, and have smart procurement or contracting and decision making across the whole piece? So that's exactly that's the challenge that the strategic action group needs to take on in thinking about what the right model is.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Gail Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Liz Ditchburn, in your opening statement, you mentioned that going forward we might have to look at different options and make difficult choices. I wonder if you could expand on that.
I think it's the question we were talking about in terms of the trajectory and the cycle over, we're talking about long-term cycles here of major investment in new infrastructure alongside maintenance, and at what point you need to sort of think about that dynamic. And Roy flagged the nature of the, certainly thinking about the trunk road network in Scotland, the nature of some of that asset, some of that is ageing now. And so, if you've got a 40-year-old motorway, there is a point, or it's more than that, I guess, aren't they now? Yeah, there's a point at which you have to face if there is now no longer just a kind of patching opportunity, and whether you need to go for a more significant investment in renewal. And I think those are the sorts of decisions that mean you might be looking at big numbers on maintenance, and at what point. And I think our job as officials, and Transport Scotland in terms of the analysis that they do, is to lay out what does that trajectory look like, what are the impacts of not increasing or attacking some of those specific challenges. So it's really just that dynamic of how do you maintain the value of the asset you currently have and continue to grow that asset by investment in developing it further.
Okay.
And I think if I could just add to that, I think that's there is an important element there around the economic worth of new infrastructure. So when we connect our cities up between Inverness and Perth and Aberdeen and Inverness, that will shorten the country. It will significantly reduce journey times. But at the same time, we also have to look at the kind of lifeline links of the 83, the supply chain to Islay and the whisky industry. It's absolutely fundamental that we make sure that is maintained in the state that's fit for purpose to get that product out into the market in as short a time as possible. So I think there's a balance to be had. We're currently coming out of that 10-year cycle, if you like, in relation to the infrastructure investment out of the recession. And as we go forward, we build the A9, the A96, we need to start to keep an eye on the remainder of the network that, we've got, Donald and the team, we've got a close watch and eye on in terms of structural condition.
Okay, thank you for that. And I'm glad you mentioned the rest of the trunk network, because we've concentrated on motorways and other roads. In my constituency, we have had the meteoric and sudden rise of the NC500. Now, locals will tell you it's been a road that's been there forever, and it's had some intense marketing, and as such, the amount of traffic on that road network has increased, I don't know by how much, but certainly by a lot. And I realise that it's a lot of Highland Council roads. How do you think, between yourselves and Bayer and Highland Council, you're going to be able to manage that and keep up that road condition?
Well, you're right, the North Coast 500 has been a phenomenal success in terms of what it was set up to do. In fact, we were approached by the North Island Initiative when they were launching it. So we've had a heads up on that, probably going back 2 or 3 years, and we've understood that. And so, and subsequently, that success, as you said, has brought volumes of traffic. And obviously, we you'd be glad to know, we monitor press every day, so we get to see how that's going down in a good sense, and also how it's caused some consternation amongst the communities in terms of volumes and speeding for what probably were quite quiet communities.
Yeah.
So we're actually on a steering group for the North Coast 500 with the Highland Council, the North Highland Initiative, the promoters of the North Coast 500, and ourselves, and our operating company, to talk about the emerging issues and about how best to address them. So there is a steering group set up. Transport Scotland's part of that, and obviously we'll need to monitor and take action when it's appropriate to do so with our stakeholder partners.
Okay.
I think for me that highlights two things, that example. One is that the world keeps changing. So you can't, even if we were to set out a blueprint now for everything that the Scottish Government ought to spend on maintenance for the next X years, the real world intervenes, and we have to be able to have to flex and to adapt and to understand what these changing trends are. Mm-hmm. But I also think that sort of example of just getting everybody together around a specific issue is a really good example of collaboration. So where we may not have seen the kind of collaboration yet that we all want to see on the overall picture, actually there are some, there's plenty of examples where people do get around the table and do really work together.
And if I could just come in there, I think another important point to try and get across is that we understand not just our asset, but the value of the asset to the Scottish economy. So we've done a number of studies now on the impact of transport in the growth sectors, and the study came back saying it suggests that our transport networks contribute to £34 billion worth, 700,000 jobs, so life sciences, creative industries, tourism. And you can see that, as somebody arrives in Scotland at any of the airports and takes a hire car, A, they want to go and see the Highlands or Edinburgh Castle or some of the major sites, and then B, they drive up the 82 and then head up to Inverness and then back down the A9. So it's absolutely fundamental that we look after that part of the asset that is driving these growth sectors within the country, and that is hugely important. And the North Coast 500 is a classic example of success, but we've got to keep pace with that success with the asset condition as well.
Okay, thanks. And hopefully we're persuading them to come further north in Inverness as well.
Yes.
I want to go on to cost of materials now and how that has affected the road maintenance budget.
Pick up on that one. Yes, it's something which Audit Scotland referred to in the report, where they stated for road structural maintenance that the material cost was the biggest element of the cost in that operation. It probably comes as no surprise, because the road structural maintenance is where you're resurfacing long lengths of road, so you're sourcing a lot of road surfacing materials and aggregates from quarries. So that's a statement of fact, if you like, that it is the biggest cost. One thing I would say from a Transport Scotland perspective, in terms of looking at that and the cost of surfacing materials, we did a piece of research a number of years ago and developed a new UK-wide specification for road surfacing materials. It's called TS 2010. And that was, we worked with industry on that to develop a new material which was more durable than existing road surfacing materials. So what we were looking for in that specification was to get a longer lasting road surfacing material. So whilst in initial upfront cost it might not necessarily be a cheaper material, it's expected to last up to twice as long, and we're now using that quite widely on the trunk road network. In the last couple of years we've done around, I think it's something around 400 lane kilometres of resurfacing using the new material. So that's expected into the future to make significant savings, because it'll be longer before we need to come back and do more maintenance. So we're certainly very aware of the cost of materials, and we are continually working with industry to do research and develop new materials.
Okay, that's really good to hear, actually, because there have been, can I ask first of all, does that apply to local authorities as well, or is that just Transport Scotland that are using those? Because there have been accusations levelled at local authorities in the past that they have been it's been a bit of a false economy by going for the cheapest aggregates, yeah. And you know, they haven't been lasting very long at all, and then they've just had to go back in and do it again.
Yeah, the TS2010 is a national specification, so it's available to any road authority that wants to use it in their maintenance programmes. One thing I would say about it, and obviously it was Transport Scotland as the national agency that developed it for trunk roads, it probably is more suited to higher speed roads.
Right.
So local authorities do have A-class roads and some dual carriageways which are high-speed roads, but also they have a lot of urban streets which aren't. So it's not the type of thing you would use in an urban street, but you could use it on principal local authority A-class roads and dual carriageways.
Okay, thank you. And just one final question, I think. When a road has been resurfaced, particularly in Highland, it's not immediately white lined. Is there a reason for that?
It largely comes down to programming and remoteness. We do encourage our operating companies to try and package up the resurfacing works so that they can bring in a white lining contractor from another part of Scotland to come and do white lining and cover quite a lot of the network while they're there, rather than back and forth doing bits and pieces at a time. That's probably part of the reason why you're witnessing that. But notwithstanding that, there is a specific requirement where they can't leave it for more than 28 days. So that, you know, they can't, you know, leave it for many weeks or months before they come back and do white lining. The other thing, which in the interim, while they're waiting on white lining contractors to come back and do the lining, they're required to put up signs notifying road users there's a section of road that's not lined. So there are specific response times where they have to do the white lining, and it's 28 days. And we do encourage them to try and package their work so that they can get somebody in to do a meaningful piece of work while they're in that area.
Is there a time limit for white lining when the road hasn't been resurfaced, but the lines have just faded and faded to an extent that they're barely there anymore?
Yeah, we do. Operating companies are required to do annual detailed inspections. White lining for all assets, ancillary assets, and white lining is part of it. I think it's a 2-year rolling basis where operating companies are required to assess the reflectivity of white lines, and where they fall below a certain level of reflectivity, then those sections of road should be put into a programme of maintenance for relining. So it's a rolling programme of looking at the reflectivity of white lines, and for those that fall below a certain level, put that into a programme of maintenance to then renew.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Just of interest, talking about reflectivity, I've maybe missed it, but I can't see anything in the report about the state of cat's eyes on Scotland's roads. Is it much the same kind of programme for the white lining as Gail describes?
Yes, it would be. White lining and cat's eyes tends to be the same contractor that will do that type of work. So cat's eyes, they're not subject to reflectivity. Cat's eyes are actually something that, again, would feed into programmes of work, but can also be picked up as part of weekly safety inspections. So where there's a section of road that maybe a single cat's eye missing is not necessarily a Category 1 defect, but if you've got a stretch of road which has several cat's eyes missing in a row, that would effectively be a Category 1 defect. And what operating companies are required to do on trunk roads in those situations is make a permanent repair within 28 days, so actually go in and replace those cat's eyes.
I mean, it's clear that in some parts of the country they're very good and they're clearly new, and in some parts of the country they just don't work anymore, they need to be replaced. But it's maybe just an observation. Monica Lennon.
Thank you. And I also put on record that I'm an elected member of South Lanarkshire Council. Good morning. Looking at page 36 of the Audit Scotland report, the report sets out that staff reductions are adding to the challenges for roads maintenance, and it's something that Colin Mayer has set out in his written evidence, and it's a pity Colin's not here today. I think his ears will be burning. He's been mentioned quite a number of times. But when we hear about some of the challenges that have been set out today, it is quite concerning that we have a reducing workforce, an ageing workforce, and it looks like that there are some steps being taken to address that. But in terms of the number of apprentices currently in training and graduates, it's a tiny number. It's a fraction of the 5,000 people who are engaged across local authorities. So when we look at the scale of the challenges and we see, you know, there's been lots of warnings that there are some real workforce pressures, is enough being done to address that?
Start there. As an ex-local authority engineer, started my career in Fife Regional Council. I think we all, it's a very small community, and we all came through much at the same time when there were large graduate intakes in local authorities. Those days are no longer, and I think the professionals that are there are, as you say, starting to head towards retirement. So mm-hmm. your street lighting engineers, your road safety engineers, your professional engineers that look after the asset, and that's part and parcel of the work that Colin has been looking at to see what can be done to address that. Mm-hmm. And Jim Valentine and I explored some time ago the potential for sharing those kind of resources amongst all the roads authorities or small groupings of roads authorities, and that may well be one of the options that comes back to the table. For ourselves, we've recognised that as well. I struggle to secure chartered civil engineers within Transport Scotland, so we've started to try and grow our own, so we've got a very successful graduate training programme, but B, engaging with the next set of engineers that are coming forward. So a large part of the work that's been done in Queens Ferry Crossing has been around the education of that infrastructure and the awareness of that in terms of STEM for school children coming forward. I don't have the exact figures to hand, but it's fairly substantial, the amount of young school children that have come through that process and are now reinvigorated into looking at STEM as a possible career choice. And likewise with A9, we've set up the A9 Academy, which again is targeting towards both school children who are currently in the system, who may, by the time they get through the system, be available to undertake work directly in their location on the A9 itself. So a couple of positive steps that we are recognising that we need to start re-energising the work of engineering in Scotland. We've got a long tradition of that. I think the Fourth Road Bridge work on social media highlighted the impact that engineers and all the other professionals involved in that particular incident can have on society. So again, there's been a great deal of profile raising with the institution and the civil engineers to try and get that skill set back into the industry again.
I don't know if Liz wants to add
no,
to that.
I mean, this man is, you know, these are all professional engineers. They're the experts in this. And I know it's something that Roy looks a lot and is head of the engineering profession for Scottish Government.
Yeah, I'm the chief road engineer. I look after 100 professional technical engineers within Transport Scotland. So we're acutely aware of the skills shortage and the need to make sure that we grow the next generation of future leaders in civil engineering and asset renewal and infrastructure.
Okay.
I would just add that in terms of road collaboration board programme that we... It's something that we are talking about. There's a bit of research being done as an initiative in there about what we need to do to re-energise that. I mean, obviously, Roy's highlighted what we've done within Transport Scotland, but I think industry-wide, I think we need to do more, and that's one of the initiatives being taken forward by the RCP, so there'll be more to come on that, but clearly there's still work to be done.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that. I just wonder where you think leadership lies. I think responsibility cuts across many departments here, and it's for everyone. But at a time when we know that there are fewer STEM teachers in schools, with school curriculum, there's different pressures. What's going to make this profession attractive when we see that, in terms of sort of local government spending, roads budgets are obviously disproportionately affected because priorities lie elsewhere? So who really is sort of promoting roads engineering and other sort of technical aspects as a future career?
Well, I think it's absolutely fundamentally lies with us at the national agency, but also others that are involved with any type of infrastructure, whether it's schools, hospitals, prisons, or whatever. I mean, we've got £6 billion worth of investment coming down the pipeline in the A9, the 96, and that's a considerable forward programme of work. taken together with all the other schemes that are coming forward, I think there's a really strong position now for school children to get back interested in STEM and building the next generation of Scotland. But it's not just about roads, it's railways, it's the ferries, it's all the other infrastructure that goes around transport. And I think it's incumbent on all of us that are involved in engineering to try and keep promoting that.
Okay, I think Gail come in and then I've got more questions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wondered what input you had into the Developing the Young Workforce programme on that particular employment issue.
Nothing directly from me, but I can take that away and look at that.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. I think you've touched on some of the exciting things that are happening in terms of infrastructure projects. We've talked a little bit today about collaborative working and perhaps where progress has been quite slow. I've been thinking about, again, some of the points that Colin's made, but City Deal strikes me as a place, as a project where they're already established and are emerging across the country, where collaborative working is obviously key. And from my experience, perhaps Glasgow and Clyde Valley, roads infrastructure and investment in roads is a big feature of City Deal. But given that we see there's obviously declining workforce, people in local government are being asked to do more, are you confident that people do have the right skills in the right places and we are working collaboratively to ensure that these projects are going to be successful?
Well, again, I can't talk for local authorities specifically, but from our perspective, Transport Scotland fully support the direction and travel of the City Deals, and actually one of my colleagues, Alison Irvine, is probably well known to all the City Deal organisations and takes an active role in ensuring that infrastructure, the national infrastructure needs and the local infrastructure needs are brought together as those schemes develop. So I think for us, we are certainly geared up in terms of the resource required to service them. For local authorities, again, it would be a question for Colin or somebody else within the local authority environment.
Maybe let me say just because the City Deals, City and Region Deals sit within my responsibility as well from a Scottish Government perspective. Obviously, local government are extremely important partners within that. I think one of the exciting things about some of the City Region thinking, it is exactly as you describe. It's the place where all the different bits fit together. And because they're not just looking at cities, they're looking at city regions, I think connectivity and transport systems are absolutely the heart of sort of saying, well, if you make these investments here, what else needs to happen to ensure that you get the benefits for that? And of course, that's not just about roads. It's often about other forms of transport as well, or about bus systems, for example. So I think there's so much that does. And I think we're just seeing, whether it's through the city region deals and the way in which local government is working together and then working with both Scottish Government and, of course, UK Government is involved in that too, or whether it's in the regional thinking in the context of the Enterprise and Skills Review as well. So I think kind of regionality mm-hmm. is just coming up in all sorts of different places, and people are seeing those opportunities and starting to work together in very different ways. And of course, some areas have been doing that for a lot longer and a lot further ahead on that. But so I think it's a really exciting thing, and it is one of the reasons why the Enterprise and Skills Review highlighted further regional thinking as one of the issues. And of course, the South of Scotland is one of the headlines of that review as well. So I think there's a big opportunity to work in very different ways. This roads issue is just one facet of that, but it's part of a bigger trend that we're seeing.
Okay, I've just got one final question, which is slightly a different topic, but Colin Mair in his submission, he talked about the impact that utility companies can have on road assets, and I think we will all have experience of this locally where you see a new sort of road surface and then a few months later it's all been dug up again. And I know there are systems in place to try and make sure that the companies coordinate with local authorities, but I wonder to what extent that is having an impact on the road assets, and is there more potential for the utility companies to be making a financial contribution?
So there's been work done recently by the work of the Scottish Roadworks Commissioner around this very point. Mm-hmm. There was an independent report done for the Commissioner, and that involved reaching out to utility companies and talking to stakeholders such as roads authorities. And there's been a long-running debate, not only in Scotland, but in the United Kingdom, about having utilities need access. They've got statutory rights anyway, as you would imagine, but they're a right to go and dig up roads, and then the standard of the reinstatement that's gone in there, and obviously that has been a bone of contention for some people. So one of the things that's being debated just now, and it's out to consultation, is the duration of the guarantee of the reinstatement, how long that should be, and so there's a we can provide details to the committee of what that consultation is. So there is a live debate around should it be longer than 2 years to reinstatement to guarantee the reinstatement by a utility company. Mm-hmm.
It'd be interesting to see that.
We can supply
Thank
details
you.
Of that to
it's
the committee.
It's on our website, but we can send the link. Yeah.
Thank you.
Alex Neil.
Can I just go back to exploring the role and performance of local authorities in road maintenance? Colin Mayer, in his submission, points out that local authorities, on average across Scotland, spend one-tenth per kilometre of money on roads that Transport Scotland spends on the trunk road network. And he clearly implies that if you look at the pattern over a longer period of time of local authority spending on roads, that basically the reduction in the road budget is being used basically to fund the increase in social care. Now, obviously, I would disagree with the need for an increase in social care funding, but nevertheless there's a clear trend there. And if you look at the Auditor General's report between 2011-12 and 2014-15, there was a 14% reduction in local authority spending on roads. So two questions. Number one, can this continue? Are we not going to reach a crisis point? Are they not cutting their nose despite their face? And secondly, there's the issue of the efficiency of the local authority operations. Now, I live in Ayr, and the Ayrshire Roads Alliance has been a total disaster. You know, I think probably Roy knows about, and no doubt Mr. Gillis knows about, the famous, now infamous, I think, Holmeson Road development in Ayr, where they laid a cycle track, made the road 10 times more dangerous than it was, and then, through public opinion, were forced to lift it. And nobody got disciplined or anything for it. It cost well over £100,000. It was not a good advert for any kind of service, let alone a shared service. And you know, given also the point the convener was making about the very, very slow progress in getting shared service type arrangements amongst local authorities in Scotland, is it not time to actually question whether local authorities really are the right bodies to be delivering this kind of service?
Well, maybe go back to your first question. Notwithstanding the politics of administrations, at what level does what? And this applies to roads nationally, regionally and locally. Can we continue the way we are going as a country? No, we cannot. I mean, I think if the Auditor General just highlighted there the funding, and I think hopefully we'll set out to you today and the evidence to the committee today and the findings in the Audit Scotland report that Scotland's roads need investment. We're talking about the existing infrastructure as well as all the arguments that have been presented today for investing in new schemes. So can it carry on as it is without something significant happening down the line? No. Mm. As I said earlier, in terms of local authorities, I mean, be careful what we'll say, because clearly we don't represent local authorities, as we've said earlier. As I said, the model for delivery of roads going forward is part of a mature debate we need to have. And that should be what's the future for local authorities and what's the future for the administration of the strategic roads. And we're up for that. Well, there's no question about that. But I'll probably leave it there.
Very diplomatic.
Yeah, I think, Mr. Neil, it's quite difficult for us, as you appreciate. It's probably easier if Colin was here. To put some context on it, though, the trunk road network, it's 6% of the total road network in Scotland, so about 55,000 kilometres, 3.5 is ours. It carries a third of all traffic, two-thirds of all HGV traffic. So it's moving the bulk of the goods and the products that are generated in Scotland across the country. Having said that, that has to come from somewhere. So the distribution centres are by and large on local authority networks. Their A-class road network is about 13%, and then the BC and unclassified is the remainder, 80%. So there's a large proportion of the network which is very socially valued, but probably isn't doing the same amount of economic generation as some of that higher class A-class road. And I guess perhaps that's the discussion that we have to have about the balance between the network itself and what it actually does to generate social, inclusive, economic growth.
So can I ask then, Roy, the obvious supplementary to that then is, are there disaggregation of the local authority spend between the different classifications of roads so that we can compare their spend per kilometre of, say, an A-class roads compared to yours?
Donald?
Well, we could do, but I mean, we need to be careful about that because, as Roy pointed out, the traffic flows on trunk roads is significantly greater, and obviously the percentage of HGVs is significantly greater. So the roads are serving different purposes. They have different levels of service. The trunk road network is the specification in the trunk road contracts is a much higher level of service in some areas than it is on local roads. And local roads, as was pointed out, there is a hierarchy there from A right down to unclassified roads. And again, there's quite a wide variance in traffic flows and level of service that's provided. So yes, you could do comparisons of how much spend there is per kilometre, but it's maybe not really a meaningful comparison because levels of service are quite different.
So how do we measure the performance of local authorities then?
Sorry, benchmark?
How should we measure the performance of local authorities? I mean, I'm coming on to the comparison, the benchmarking between your performance and the international comparisons and the rest of the UK, which is a good way of looking at where we're at. But how should we measure the performance of local authorities? What's the best way to measure whether they're doing a good job or not?
Well, Transport Scotland hasn't done that, and it wouldn't be our role to do that. But obviously, Audit Scotland have looked at the performance of local authorities through their audit, and obviously they've picked up on a few things, some positive, not so positive, and the less positive was around the collaboration and sharing that we were talking about and the pace. But the one thing they do highlight is that the condition of local roads, notwithstanding the reductions in budgets and the pressures on workforce and all the rest of it, is that their road condition is reported as being relatively stable over the piece. So I suppose, I mean, local authorities would quite rightly look upon that as a positive, that notwithstanding the pressure they're under, they've managed to maintain the condition of the roads at a fairly stable level, although there is potential with underinvestment that at some point that falls off a cliff at some point if you don't do something about it. So there's a positive there in terms of their road condition. And the other thing that Audit Scotland highlighted about local authorities is that they all now have published road asset management plans. And I suspect that's what's helping them maintain the roads in a stable condition. So where we're at the moment, the measure of performance of local authorities is on the road condition, and have they implemented road asset management plans. And there's positives there. But the sharing and collaboration element, which could unlock, might unlock efficiencies, that's where the performance is not so good. That's certainly my take on the Audit Scotland report.
And is there any evidence, to the best of your knowledge, that the few areas that do have shared services, such as the Ayrshire one, but there are others, that they are better performers or more efficient than the areas that don't have such arrangements?
I think that there's limited evidence that we have of that, and it's kind of it depends who you speak to, I think.
I think there's an exhibit in the Audit Scotland report which I think is significant. It's worth referencing. It's the graph that shows the performance. Yeah, if you look at Exhibit 9, could maybe draw.
Yeah, what page is it on?
is it?
That's the...
Oh, it's here, yeah. It's
page,
so,
page 22,
if I draw your... so the two councils which are in the Ayrshire Rose Alliance are South Ayrshire and East Ayrshire.
Yeah.
And you'll see South Ayrshire are spending less and East Ayrshire are spending more. So obviously the point I think we've been making across the piece is that obviously administrations make a decision about what they feel they want to spend their money on.
Yeah.
So although they share a service, one council's made a decision to take one tack with the money they've got, yeah, and one's taken another decision.
Right. But I'm looking more in terms of what they do. Is there any evidence in terms of efficiencies? For example, if you're running a shared services organisation, do you get benefits in terms of procurement? Because you're presumably buying more materials, for example. Do you get benefits in terms of economies of scale because you're covering a much bigger mileage of road? What I'm trying to get at,
yeah,
is...
Sure.
Is there evidence that shared services actually lead to cost savings, improvement in efficiency, overall better performance?
Yeah. There's certainly evidence where shared procurement can bring efficiencies.
Yeah.
It's something we've looked at in Transport Scotland, and we have entered into shared procurements with the Welsh Government on undertaking road condition surveys.
Right.
We have a contract which runs for a period of 6 or 7 years, but annually through that contract we're measuring the condition of trunk roads both in Scotland and in Wales. Now, we used to do it separately. We had our own contracts for that, and we paid a certain rate per kilometre for those road condition surveys to be done. But we found that we were actually both using the same contractor. So when our contracts came to an end, we decided to run a joint procurement to get the economies of scales. We're almost doubling the length of trunk road network to be measured in the one contract. And that reduced our cost of road condition service by a third by getting that economy of scale.
Yep.
So certainly there are benefits through shared procurement. You will obviously, the more you buy in bulk, the cheaper the rate, effectively.
And to be fair, there is some evidence in the Audit Scotland report that there are some councils improving their performance while others are pretty stagnant.
Okay. I've just found a bit in Colin's in his response on page 4. I think he recognises exactly what you're saying. He says, in relation to question 4, current benchmarking data does not as yet show lower costs or better outcomes in shared road services,
yeah,
but they do create a framework for resilience and economies of skill and scale given forward budget pressures.
And so, I think an obvious thing that this committee presumably would look at is what more can be done to demonstrate and to allow us to monitor more closely the comparative efficiencies of the 32 local authorities and yourselves, obviously. Can I just finally come to the international comparisons between Transport Scotland and the rest of the UK, but other countries as well? And can I say right away, obviously I recognise the very substantial part of your budget now that's invested in new road building, because I've signed all the major ones off myself when I was Infrastructure Secretary, and will take credit for them, by the way, including the dualling of the A9 and the A96 and the M73, M74 corridor. And I just want to make sure that's on the record, by the way.
Can I have a question, please?
Clearly, we're a wee bit behind our colleagues in the rest of the UK and indeed internationally. So I presume you have a strategy, a programme, a plan,
yeah,
to get nearer to at least the European average.
Yeah, I mean, I'll let Donald come in on this, but it was as we started to look at this a few years back, I was very keen to try and identify, A, did we have the right standard, first and foremost, in Scotland for the trunk road network? And B, how did we compare? So we did a piece of work with our consultants to firstly understand whether you can compare like for like. And,
yeah,
and it is quite difficult because every roads authority takes a slightly different approach, yeah, to monitoring condition. But we found a mechanism which allowed us to get very close to a kind of a league table, if you like, where we are. I have to say that France, Italy and Ireland are worse than us, but we are where we are in the table. But what we did identify was that the standards that we should be aiming for,
benchmarks.
No, the top level.
In Italy and Ireland, yeah.
The top position that we should be aiming for our trunk road network is 3% of motorways for intervention, 6% for dual carriageways, and 8% for single carriageways. And we're currently sitting at 6, 8, and 10 for those categories. So we've certainly got a vision of where we want to be.
Yep.
And England, they're sitting about 3% for their asset. I think, Donald, correct me if I'm wrong, it was Canada and New Zealand for 6 and 8% for
that's right,
single
yeah.
carriageway and dual carriageway, respectively. But I'll hand over to Donald.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Roy's kind of touched on most of it there, particularly around the, you know, the difficulty in benchmarking. There are sort of some health warnings that come with that. And where it all came from really was we were acutely aware of all the new infrastructure that was planned, the kind of stuff that you were taking credit for there. We were acutely aware that all that was coming through the pipeline. And what does that mean for the rest of the network that doesn't have major interventions planned? We're going to end up with a stark contrast, if you like. So what we were tasked with doing was looking at a long-term strategy of aiming for a target that would bring the rest of the network up to a certain target. But the question was, well, what is that target? You know, in terms of road condition, what target should we be aiming for? So the task was to look internationally and see if anybody else had targets that we could compare with. So we did that, and we did report on that, and that's in that kind of league yep. table that you mentioned. But one thing I would say is that it's very... That comparison, we couldn't directly compare with other countries. And really what it came down to was, do other countries, they have a threshold where they look to do maintenance on a road. So it's where you intervene to undertake maintenance, what's the percentage? We all have the same target to do maintenance at a certain threshold, but the thresholds are different. So that's where it becomes difficult. So... Essentially, our main comparison was with, as Roy pointed out, the trunk roads in England. So we then did, we've got the ability to do various financial scenarios which can get us to a particular target over a defined period of years. So that's where the 3%, the 6%, the 8% target came from for roads in need of maintenance for motorways, duals and singles, respectively. And we can produce or have produced financial targets which, over a 20-year period, because it's at the end of a 20-year period that all the new infrastructure will be, the current new planned infrastructure will be delivered. So there's a financial plan which is a vision, if you like, for what we can do with the rest of the network to get it up to that kind of 3% or 4% that's mentioned in the Audit Scotland report for England. So that vision sits there. But obviously that's looking way into the future and availability of funding, well, that'll have to go through the government sausage machine at the appropriate time. But the vision is there, and that comes back to the choices that Liz was mentioning earlier, that there's choices to be made about whether we actually commit to delivering on that.
Interestingly enough, in terms of road safety, although condition is one element, you know, presenting a safe network is equally as important. We sit 7th out of 42 countries at the minute.
Good.
So Norway, Malta and Sweden and England are above us, and then you take GB and UK. So we've got a very good, strong track record of safely maintaining, managing and operating our network with the funds that we have. And we've got the lowest road safety casualty figures on record, and that's I think that's something to be proud of.
Can I take credit for that as well, then?
No. Monica Lennon, briefly.
Thank you, Kevin, for letting me back in. It was just when Alec Neil was talking about performance, I was quite intrigued by a point, again, that Colin Mayer had made in his submission, that in relation to local roads, the use of a single national corporate indicator, the Road Condition Index, for roads does not tell the whole story. And it tells us that previously we looked at street lighting and bridges as part of that information, and then that was stripped out, but it looks like it's going to be put back in. I just wonder if you could briefly say who made that decision and why, and again, who's making this change and why? What do we hope to get from this?
I think it comes down to the Audit Scotland audit and in terms of the scope and the brief for that. I think in speaking to local authorities, in planning that audit, local authorities had good information on roads in terms of an indicator that they could provide that was auditable. but probably overall 32 authorities, they possibly didn't have the same level of information that you could do a comparison on condition for structures and lighting. Mm-hmm. But I know through their new asset management plans that there are models in place that enable them to better compare condition for structures and lighting also, which possibly relates back to changes in the whole of government accounts where authorities now are required to report asset value in their accounts for the roads, and to be able to do that, obviously you need to have good information on all your assets, not just the road carriageway itself, but obviously bridges and lighting as well. So I suspect it was down to what was available for the Audit Scotland review, rather than any particular decision about whether that information is in or out. It was what was available to be considered as part of the audit.
Thank you. Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. A number of questions arising from the questions that have come earlier. First of all, just on Mr. Neil's point there, so how much would it cost? What do your projections show as the actual cost required to get the Scottish trunk road network up to the same standard as English road network?
Take that. We've looked at their structural maintenance budget is the particular part of the budget that influences the road condition index. Current budgets for structural road maintenance are around £40 million per annum to do structural maintenance. Audit Scotland highlighted from the information they asked us for that to maintain current condition, we should be spending about £62 million. In terms of a vision going into the future, over 20 years to get to the level that of our target, the 3%, it would be an annual budget of £79 million.
Okay.
That's from our financial planning, and that would be over a 20-year horizon.
So £79 million per year,
yeah,
for 20 years is, yeah, what's required, yeah, to get there. Thank you.
Yeah.
But the footprint of the network continues to increase significantly, thanks, of course, to Mr. Neil. So with increased footprint comes increased maintenance, requires increased funding, but of course what we know is that funding is not increasing for the trunk roads. So what do your projections show is the impact of that?
Well, that I would expect would actually have a positive benefit, because if you take the Central Scotland motorway improvements at the moment, the M8, M73, M74, that will obviously introduce fairly lengthy, I can't remember the kilometres, Roy, but fairly lengthy new sections of motorway on our network, and that will replace old life expired infrastructure. So the old life expired stuff comes out the equation, and you're replacing it with something new, which you won't really have to do too much maintenance on for quite some time. You'll obviously have to cut the grass and empty the gullies and all that sort of thing, but you won't have to fill potholes or resurface lengths of roads. So the new stuff will actually have a positive benefit on that financial plan.
Can I just say two things as well? I think, well, firstly, to say, I mean, you said the budgets aren't increasing for trunk roads. The draft 17-18 budget does propose an increase. So I think, as I said at the beginning, the draft 17-18 budget proposes an increase from in the total on management, maintenance and operation of the trunk road network, proposes an increase from £305 million, which was increased in year, so that baseline increased in year because of the £15 million extra that was allocated. So the proposal is that it moves from 305 to 368. So that is the proposal within the draft budget, is that it increases. I think the other thing I would say is we need to remember what the kind of financial models that from which we can derive numbers like £62 million per year or you know, and the reality of that down to actual in-year and multi-year budgeting. Those give us an idea of, you know, they kind of take some assumptions and they give us an idea of the sorts of levels of investment that will be required over a quite long period of time. Obviously, you then have choices about the phasing of that, about front-loading and back-loading. You have choices about how you target and spend that money. So there's a lot, there's a tremendous amount below the level of that. I think that, you know, it's just important to make that distinction between a financial model, which gives some interesting information and which we obviously were keen is available for all decision makers and is indeed made public through the publication of the road asset management plan, and then how that is then turned into in-year, multi-year, and budgeting process. So it doesn't tell you the budget answer. It tells you something about the nature of the level of investment required.
Thank you. So just going back to another point, but coming off the trunk roads and going into the local, in Mr. Mayor's paper, he talks about prioritisation. One of the constraints on councils is that they have to prioritise certain aspects of their provision. Do you think, bluntly, that it's time, given the importance to the economy that you've talked about throughout, and safety, which we'll come back to, is it time that the councils had to prioritise the road network?
I think these are decisions for councils to take, and for the number of councillors on this committee, I think that's the current setup is very much that those are decisions for local governments to take in accordance with their local needs and on the basis of subsidiarity of decision making. Do I think it's time that we set something different? I mean, that would be a policy change, and that's not where we are currently.
A couple of quick points. Mr. Brannan mentioned safety, quite rightly, and you mentioned, Ms. Ditchburn, about the cutting the grass and filling the gullies and things. The Audit Scotland report says that road conditions are a key factor in safety for motorists, for cyclists, for pedestrians. Is it reasonable to assume that the risks to safety increase if the road condition declines, and are there any studies being done into that?
Okay, yeah. So, yes, if road condition decline, they're obviously beyond what it was designed to do in sort of skid resistance, you would expect the risk of an accident to increase. If I maybe just sort of expand on that, in 2010, the Scottish Government launched its strategic vision for reducing casualty figures in Scotland to a target of 2020. It was the first administration in the United Kingdom to do that. Now, obviously, road safety involves education, enforcement and encouragement, as well as engineering. From our part as a statutory trunk road authority, we obviously take a steer on the engineering aspect directly on our roads. So we, sitting below that, we have a strategic road safety plan, which we refreshed last year, and it stood us in good stead. Now, as part of that refresh, again, we looked across for international best practice. But what we do on an annual basis is look at the strategic trunk road network and look at its performance in terms of accidents. And with the resources we have this year, I think we've got just over £8 million, we target specifically where there are known accident problems. And what I mean by that is killed and seriously injured. It's important that we target these areas as opposed to where there might be a perceived or public perception of safety. So we target that specifically with known successful interventions such as skid resistance or improving signage and lining, improving drainage. So it can be quite technologically high. For example, probably the highest profile example of an intervention through that team is average speed cameras on the A9. Or, as I say, it could be fairly low-tech stuff, such as improving signing and lining on a route action plan.
Can I just say something about the link there between... The link between road condition and safety, that's where maintenance policy comes into play. And obviously, in terms of funding, where you might want to do major maintenance work, and your road condition indicator tells you that you should be doing major maintenance work, but for whatever reason you have to delay it, that doesn't necessarily mean, yes, your condition indicator might go down, but that doesn't mean that section of road is unsafe, because our maintenance regime then is to continue to monitor it and do patching repairs as and when required. And that's a perfectly legitimate maintenance policy. All roads authorities nationally and internationally do that. So it's through that policy that we're always targeting safety as the primary concern.
Just if you wouldn't mind completing the picture on that, the report shows that the biggest cause of road accidents appears to be driver error and reaction. Are you able to fill in the other side of the road maintenance piece as to what's being done to address the driver error aspect? Is that something that falls with you? Or?
Yeah, I mean, there is a strategic group which oversees the delivery of the government strategy of the 2020 targets, and that's chaired by the Minister for Transport and Islands, and it meets three times a year to go through the... there's a number of action plans in that, and that's online, and that covers off, as I say, education, enforcement and engineering encouragement. And the ethos is road safety is everybody's responsibility, from the designers of roads to businesses that use roads to pedestrians, everything. So we're constantly looking at that, and that itself was looked at last year because we obviously 2015 represented the sort of midpoint to where we are on the journey towards achieving those targets. We are on track against those targets, but obviously we have to keep a close eye on that if we're going to land them by 2020. So that was refreshed last year, and as part of that, we refreshed our strategic road safety plan.
I'd like to ask a couple of questions around the performance concerns around Bear Scotland. I assume I'm directing most of these questions at Hugh Gillis, as responsible for trunk roads.
Well, actually,
is that correct?
I can defer to my colleague Donald, who oversaw the investigation.
Okay, thank you. So I'd first like to ask about the significant failings. Mr. Morrison, if you oversaw the investigation, I believe that the group called PAG Plus did the investigation into some of the allegations around failings around Bear Scotland, and you found that there were significant failings around the performance under this contract, which included work that was being done incorrectly documented and inaccurately recorded by Bear Scotland, Bear charging for work that was not undertaken, and to a lesser extent not charging for work which it did undertake, and the controls which Bear should have to deliver the contracts were either not in place or were not properly enforced by it. Can you tell me if this raised concerns within Transport Scotland when you came up with these significant failings and what was done to address them?
Yep, it absolutely did raise concerns, and obviously the first thing I would say is that, as the report identified, Transport Scotland was overcharged by £280,000, and that's obviously unacceptable. That money was recovered from Bear Scotland. So having said that, and that obviously came out of the thorough investigation that you mentioned there, and the failings that were identified. So if I could maybe just say a wee bit more about specifically what those failings were, and then come on to the improvement aspects of that. As you probably noticed, most of it is, pretty much all of it, was around routine carriageway patching. What Bear did in undertaking that operation was they identified all the patching that was required on the network, as we might have expected, and identified the defects, and they planned their programme of patching to take care of that. And in doing so, PAG identified that there was no evidence that what they'd identified needed done was not justified. Patches were required. What Bear then did was, they, as is normal practice, they designed the patching work that was required. But with patching being a routine operation, the difficulty is that until you actually go on site and actually start digging up the defective piece of road, you don't actually know how deep you're going to have to go till you find good material. So in designing that work and estimating the cost of it, you have to make assumptions, and there's effectively what you might call a default design for a patch, which you'll certainly know the area, but you don't necessarily know the depth. So the default is for a patch is 100 millimetres or 4 inches, typically is the depth of a patch. And that goes to the operations team to undertake the work. They order the material and go and do the work. And what was found was there was evidence that they'd gone on site and they'd done the patches and excavated out the relevant amount of material. So they did what was justified. In some cases, that was deeper than 100 millimetres, and in some cases, that was less than 100 millimetres in depth. When an operating company does an operation like that, what they're supposed to do is, at the end of the process, they amend the operations instruction with the correct depth. But what Bear were doing, they weren't doing that. They were effectively, this is where the failings in the management process were, the design depth fed through to the final depth, and that was what was charged. And in some cases, what that meant was, and this was established by PAG going in and doing a coring exercise on a representative sample, some patches were deeper than 100 millimetres and some were less. So there was a mixture of overcharging and undercharging. And the net position was an overcharge of £280,000. So an improvement plan was obviously required on the back of that. And I should say that the error rate that PAG found was something of the order 6.6% on the 30 sites that they visited. In terms of evaluating the £280,000, that was extrapolated over all the patching operations that they had done since the start of the contract. So that's where the 280,000 came from. And on the back of that, we obviously took this up with Bayer Scotland and invited them to respond to that and put in place a rigorous process to ensure that it wouldn't happen again. And in doing so, they've put together a 13-point action plan, which is well progressed at the moment. And we are asking PAG to monitor and audit that improvement plan.
Okay. I mean, the £280,000, significant amount of taxpayers' money that's been paid to a contractor that's, you know, for work that has been overcharged. Are you confident that that total just reached £280,000 and that there wasn't more?
Yes, we actually, the allegations originated in Bayer's North East unit. So obviously we started there and did a thorough investigation, but Bayer obviously have a contract in the northwest. So we did the same exercise in the northwest. We did a coring operation, and the £280,000 is a combination of the error rate across both units. And at the same time, we also looked at the units in the south of Scotland, the southeast and the southwest, to see if there was a similar pattern there, different operating companies. But those coring investigations gave the south units a clean bill of health. There was no findings of overcharging or undercharging in the south.
That was my next question. I mean, obviously there are four or five trunk road operators operational in Scotland, aren't there? So you checked the others, and it was just Bayer Scotland that were overcharging the Scottish Government?
Correct.
Okay. And has the contract come up for renewal since? I mean, this is quite concerning. Out of, you know, if the other trunk road operators can get this right, obviously there is a way for certainly the teams on the ground to know how to do this and to get it right. So it seems strange that Bayer Scotland would be the only one to get it wrong. Has the contract come up for renewal since?
The contract has come up for renewal, and the contracts in the northwest and southwest, the northeast contract, which was subject to the allegations, that has not come up for renewal. That's got another 2 years to run before we would consider extensions. But the contract in the northwest for Bayer and the southwest for Transerve came up for not for renewal, consideration of extensions, and we thoroughly explored that with both operating companies that were interested in whether they would want to pursue extensions by providing a business case, and we went through a rigorous process with both Bayer in the northwest and the southwest, and extended both of those contracts.
So Bayer's contracts have been extended despite the fact they overcharged the government £280,000, and despite the fact you have other contractors that don't overcharge the Scottish Government.
Yes, we had to take in a much wider view other
did
than
those other, sorry to interrupt, did those other contractors bid for the contract that was up for renewal?
No, it wasn't put up for renewal and put out to tender.
It was an extension.
There's a contractual provision which enables extension of all five of the trunk road operating company contracts. So there's a requirement on us to consider whether we wish to extend those contracts at points in time, and we took into account a wide range of factors in coming to that conclusion.
But you decided to extend it?
Yes.
Is that wise for the Scottish Government to extend a contract to a company that has a proven record of overcharging the Scottish taxpayer by hundreds of thousands of pounds?
Well, I think obviously it would have been a different outcome if the outcome of the investigation had uncovered deliberate acts of overcharging. What it obviously uncovered was a process failure. The trunk road operating companies are...
But there are four other trunk road operators in Scotland with a proven track record of not overcharging the taxpayer?
There's three in total. There's three that we employ in total across the five units. Yes.
Would they not be able to take on? Would Scottish taxpayers not have more confidence if one of these companies who don't overcharge them were to take that contract forward?
If we'd chosen not to extend the contract and put it out to tender, in other words, if we'd not extended the Bear Northwest contract, we would have had to have gone through a tender exercise and put it out onto the open market and give those other companies, as you say, the opportunity to bid for that contract. Mm-hmm. That the Bear wouldn't get extended, but of course in doing so, Bear would have been entitled to bid for that contract as well and could have gone through a successful tender process and won that contract. And the other aspect is that regardless of whether we extended the contract in the North West, they were going to be working for us in the North East anyway for another few years.
You're saying there's a really important set of issues here, and Hugh, you should say some more as well, perhaps, which is around the way in which we need to assess our contractors, which will be a range of factors. You know, and there's a lot of money at stake in all of these contracts, and there's performance issues and everything. Now, clearly, the process failing that was found was completely unacceptable. But things do happen, and I suppose I think what the team has done is, on the back of really forensic, comprehensive investigation, has held a very, very high bar to say, Bear, you messed up here. You need to absolutely prove to us that you are worthy of maintaining this contract, and you need to show us how you're going to improve, how you're going to ensure it never happens again. And we want to see you really going, you know, not just doing what you think the minimum might be. We want to see you going beyond that. And I think, and the team should say more about it. But the response that's been seen from Bear, I think there is confidence in that response, and it has gone beyond just fixing the immediate to saying, actually, how can they continue to strengthen and improve their own systems more broadly?
If I can make a point to respond to that, I take your point. You know, mistakes are made. But the other three operating contractors did not make the same mistakes. They have not tried to rip off the Scottish taxpayer, which is what Bear have done by £280,000. If you have a track record as a Scottish government of employing another three companies that can do the job you ask them to do at good value to the taxpayer, why on earth would the Scottish government choose to extend a contract of a company who has overcharged the taxpayer?
I think it's really important to clarify again, and as Donald said, they did not try to rip off the Scottish government. If we had overcharged you by £280,000. If the evidence, if the investigation had found evidence of criminality, evidence of fraud, evidence of systematic willful overcharging, then that would have been a completely different case. And I think it's really important that this is understood in these terms. It's an important and significant process failing, but it's a process failing that resulted in some undercharging and some overcharging, and that's absolutely unacceptable.
But Ms. Ditchburn, is it not up to you as Director General of Economy, the Scottish Government, to make sure that you're hiring contractors that don't have process failings, and there are other options open to why extend a contract of a contractor who can't do that?
Because the contractor was able to demonstrate, and the team should say more about it, the contractor was able to demonstrate that they accepted that, they completely accepted it, they accepted that that was a failing, they have put in place significant mitigation to both address that, they've reimbursed us, and they put in place action to address that risk going forwards. But I think,
set some context in terms of the contracts and the approach that we've got. Our contracts are publicly available, so anybody can go in and see the contracts and the requirements of any of our operating companies in each of the geographic areas. And when you go in there, you'll see the level of detail that's required to comply with both undertaking work and bidding for work. We have a number of different mechanisms of monitoring our contracts, one of them through our own staff within Transport Scotland, and they monitor probably around about 54 different indicators in the contract. We have payment adjustment factors, which allow us to withhold payment from our contractors if the incorrect level of documentation has not been forthcoming in the monthly statements. Separate to the internal review of our contracts, we also have the performance audit group. CH2M and AECOM and TRL, we've appointed them on a third term, 7 years. They are independent, and they monitor the operating companies over a whole range of different key performance indicators. some of those indicators in the PAG report, you'll see that some of those indicators indicate process failures across all the units. But the rigorous standards that we apply to the contracts to ensure we get the highest level of service has been recognised elsewhere. Western Australia took our model and have called it a performance evaluation group, but something very similar to our approach. So the uniqueness we've got is we've got both an internal audit approach on it, but also an external audit approach on it. The independent report that PAG does is independent. So they write it, we check it for factual accuracy, but it's published on their website and it indicates performance across a range of different measures from management of service, quality of service, financial management and delivery of service.
Mr Brannan, I understand that the Scottish Government Transport Scotland has all its processes. I just don't think the Scottish taxpayer would understand why the Scottish Government would choose to renew a contract of a contractor who has overcharged the Scottish Government when there are other contractors in Scotland working for the Scottish Government who don't do that. But let me move to my next question, and it's a bit around governance of this contract, because there was someone in Transport Scotland, when the complaints were made, the performance concerns about Bear Scotland by constituents of mine, they were made directly to Transport Scotland for investigation. These concerns were immediately forwarded by email to the company, Bear Scotland. The email, I have it here, is dated 21st of May 2015. It's from a man called Jonathan Moran. Was he in your team? And it's salutated gents, which I think is a very cosy salutation between Transport Scotland and a government contractor, but perhaps that's just civil service speak. And then it goes on to outlay, to detail the concerns that were made. Can you tell me, in terms of governance between Transport Scotland and a contractor that the Scottish Government is paying, is it appropriate if concerns are raised just to immediately forward them on to the contractor for their information? Or would it not be more appropriate to carry out an internal investigation first?
I'm not familiar with the email that you've got there, but what
I can send it to you after.
Well, I could probably get it at our end anyway. I mean, what I would say is that the Transport Scotland network maintenance teams, which Jonathan is part of, they're the ones that are managing the contracts on a day-to-day basis, and they do deal with the public regularly and get many complaints, well, not many complaints, but when they get complaints coming from members of the public, they will then make inquiries with the operating company to verify if there's any substance to those and get a response from the operating company. In other words, what are you doing about this? So I suppose that in that particular case, if he had complaints put to him by a member of the public, then the first course of action would actually have been what's your view on this? I accept that the difference in this situation is that these were allegations of fraud. So I would suggest that in that particular case, yes, a different approach could have been taken. In terms of the salutation, I mean, I wouldn't read anything into that. I mean, we obviously have professional working relationships with the operating company staff, and these are good professional working relationships, and we're dealing with these people on a day-to-day basis, and we meet them regularly in meetings, so, you know, to address them as gents might not. I mean, I wouldn't read anything into that. It doesn't suggest anything in terms of our rigour, if you like, in how we manage the contract.
No, I'm just going to ask Donald Morrison a further question. So you're saying that in terms of governance of a contract, it is appropriate for these concerns to be immediately forwarded to the contractor for their opinion on them before an internal investigation is conducted?
Well, in terms of public complaints, yes. Yes, it would be. The difference in this case, I acknowledge, and is that they were allegations of fraud, and that puts a different perspective on the type of complaint. But generally, complaints which we receive are directed to the operating company because they're the best place to deal with complaints. And in fact, there's a national helpline for road users to make complaints to operating companies.
Okay, but when this... No, I'm sorry, I'm going to continue my line of questioning with Mr. Morrison. But when this was followed up... and when Mr. Jonathan Mayer was challenged on this, he then said that he had sent the email erroneously to Bayer Scotland. I can reassure you of my impartiality, and my mistake was a genuine oversight, for which I again apologise. He means sending the email to Bayer Scotland. So what is the Transport Scotland's process around complaints or concerns being raised around a contractor? Is it to refer it immediately to the contractor, or is it, as Jonathan Mayer seems to refer to in his subsequent email, that that was a mistake and he shouldn't have done that? Which is it?
For public complaints, we would forward them to the operating company to deal with. Okay. In this case,
so why did he apologise for the email?
Because these were allegations of fraud.
Can I just say, I think you're raising extremely important points. This is not a detail that that we've discussed as a team. I think the information that you're providing to us now is worthy of investigation. We will take this away and we will properly look at what the process was that we undertook and whether we handled that information appropriately. You are absolutely right that in any sensible whistleblowing policy, there will be very clear guidance around confidentiality of that material and protection of whistleblowers. If we have failed, and I don't know whether we have or not, but if we have failed to do that appropriately, we will take action. But what I'd like to do is get the information and take it away for investigation.
I think I've got one thing to add to that. I think if, Donald, you can say a bit more about when you took over the actual investigation and the fact that there was a shroud of secrecy around exactly what you undertook and involved the police in that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when the investigation itself was instigated, that was undertaken by PAG, as we said. That was done independently of Transport Scotland. Transport Scotland had no role to play in the investigation itself that PAG undertook. PAG completed the investigation and obviously reported back to us with their report. Our only involvement during the process was to get updates from them on their progress, in effect, and where they were at with coring and all that kind of stuff. So PAG were left to go on and undertake a rigorous investigation and produce the report. When that was complete, we then shared that with Police Scotland because the allegations had originally gone to Police Scotland as well. And when they had received the allegations, they contacted us to ask if we were doing anything about it. And we said that we had instigated a full independent investigation. So they were content with that, but just wanted to know what the outcome was. So we shared the report with them at the end. We sat down with them and had quite a detailed meeting to go through the report. And the detectives that we spoke to were quite content that we'd done a thorough investigation, and they were content with the scope and extent of that investigation and the outcome of it, and were satisfied that there was no evidence of any criminal activity. And in the final piece in that jigsaw was that before they could sign it off and say they weren't going to take it any further, they wanted their chief inspector to have a look at it, and then they would confirm whether they intended to undertake any further investigation, which they duly did.
Yes. The police told me that they had seen the failings and the overcharging, but it hadn't gone as far as criminal activity. In my letter from DCI Andrew Patrick, who undertook the police investigation, which is now closed, so it's fine for the committee to discuss this. The final issue I want to ask about is the contractual arrangements around scrap and waste management. Because it's my understanding, and the police's understanding as well, when they looked at the contract, that waste materials, whether they're lampposts that have been brought down or road signs that have been brought down, it's written into the contract that that waste is then taken to the scrap merchant and that cash or cheque is then given to the contractor. And this is outlined in the police's letter. It says, this waste contract has been obtained and shows that where Bayer Scotland recovers any items during site clearance, ownership of that property becomes Bayer Scotland's. The subsequent disposal of the property is at the discretion of Bayer Scotland and they are entitled to the credit value. Can you tell me, is it appropriate for government contractors to profit from Crown property and for that to be written into their contracts?
It's not written in as a requirement or an avenue for them to make profit. They have to, for all the operations that they do, they provide us with rates and prices.
The police told me that the disposal of waste and the receipts from that waste to go to the contractor was in the contract.
It is in the contract, yes.
Sorry, I thought you just said it wasn't.
No, it is, sorry, yes. Any waste arising from the operations is the responsibility of the contractor to dispose of. And if they get any credit for that, then they win the benefit, if you like. But these are contracts which are, in terms of the operations, provided with rates and prices. And in pricing the contract, in order to win the contract, they're putting in competitive bids, and in order to do that, they will make an estimate of anything that they can win through the operations that they might gain, and they will take account of that in their pricing. So whilst they get the benefit of the value of any scrap, the receipt of that will be included in their pricing of the contract. In other words, they can, in order to win the contract, they can lower their prices because they can anticipate that they might get some value back in the value of scrap. That's fairly normal for all term maintenance contracts. Scottish ministers, indeed Transport Scotland, have no facility to process scrap or indeed to store anything of that nature in order to...
No, I don't suggest they do. If I can just finish. I don't suggest they do. It just surprises me that the receipts would go to the company. Yeah. Are you saying that it's written into all of the Trunk Road contractors' contracts that waste?
It's written into all of those contracts, and indeed, I suspect it's common practice for all types of contracts throughout the UK and beyond, I would suspect.
If I can just continue my line of questioning, are you confident that waste is always proper waste and is not pulled down perhaps a bit before time? If the contractors are actually getting the receipts for this, it seems quite interesting arrangement.
Well, I mean, to undertake operations, obviously, it would need to be part of a planned programme of maintenance, which had been approved by Transport Scotland, taking down assets which don't require to be taken down. I think if that was happening through the rigour of the processes that we've got in place, I think we would have picked that up. There's no evidence from any audit or investigation, and obviously we're continually auditing these operating companies on the justification of their maintenance programmes. There's been no evidence to suggest that there's anything like that going on, but it is perfectly legitimate for them to process waste receive the benefit of that.
Okay. Roy Brown, you wanted to add...
Just to set that in context in terms of the contractual conditions, on the Queens Ferry crossing, the temporary steel that's used to support the deck at the minute is the contractor's, and it's for him to do what he pleases with it. So that steel is scrap. Once it comes down, it'll be disposed of by the contractor. Most contracts across the country, civil engineering contractors, allow for the product of waste or whatever it may be, is the responsibility of the contractor. Now, the substantial amount of steel on Queens Ferry Crossing in terms of scrap, there's obviously an element that would have been priced in there by the contractors taking that scheme forward, given the nature of the temporary works.
Colin Beattie.
Obviously, members of the committee have not had a chance to view the documents you've been referencing. Yes. Would it be possible to circulate them around the members?
Absolutely. The ones that I've referenced that are not in the papers, yes, I will. Yes. Hugh Gillis.
Notwithstanding everything that's gone before, and I appreciate that we've given a commitment to come back on the early exchanges, one of the things that we've had to weigh in terms of the extension of the North West and the South West contract for the two-year extension from 2018 to 2020 would be the future shape and form of 5G. And if I can take you back to, we've had quite an extended conversation about the future of roads administration in Scotland. And we'd been asked specifically, now this, at the end of the day, if any criminality, just reiterating what's gone before, any criminality, any fraud, there'd be no question that we would not have extended these contracts. But we did, notwithstanding that, weigh the fact that there'd been requests from local government from COSLA and SOLAS to extend, to give them the opportunity to get ready to discuss 5G and what future road administration in Scotland will look like. If we hadn't had that, we'd be in a 5G procurement process now, and we would have probably stuck with the model we had, more or less, in terms of the trunk road network being administered and operated through an operating contract model.
No, I mean, I understand that the investigation concluded that there was no criminality involved. What surprises me, it's this committee's job to follow the public pound. What surprises me is this Scottish Government is extending contracts to a contractor who has a track and proven record of overcharging the Scottish Government. But can I thank you all for your evidence this morning, and I now move the committee into private session.